side to the system of Celtic belief, the so-called cult of the human head.
One of the most interesting discoveries made long time ago on excavations in southern France were of columns, which we now think belong to temples, and inside those columns were niches, and in each niche was a human skull. Now this ties in with some evidence we have from the ancient Roman writers, who tell us that the Celts would collect the heads, they decapitate their defeated victims, and they would take those skulls back.
These are the heads of battle victims who were obviously dedicated to the gods. The human head was obviously very important to the Celts as a symbol. I wouldn't want to go so far as to say there was a cult of the human head, but what is clear from the literary testimony and from the archaeological record that human heads had significance, had importance. And so heads were, they were regarded as the seat of understanding, means of identity, and therefore you could represent gods just by heads alone, and clearly your tally of your trophies of human heads were important to your own status as a warrior.
Within the Celtic tribe, sacred rituals were ultimately the responsibility of the augurers, or prophets. It was their task to carry out the business of sacrifice. Typically, an animal would be slaughtered, and its organs would then be examined for signs of events to come. But there were times when the object of the sacrifice would not be an animal at all. For the Celts, the life of an individual is subject to the will of the gods. If it was felt that the gods were in any way displeased, they would have to be placated by the sacrifice of human life. In normal circumstances, the victims would be criminals, but not always. Innocent men were often put to a ritual death. In the first century BC, Julius Caesar described an even more extreme form of Celtic human sacrifice. Some tribes have colossal images made of wickerwork, the limbs of which they fill with living men. They are then set on fire and the victims are burned to death.
I suspect that Julius Caesar was telling the truth there, because we do have evidence for sacrifices, deliberate sacrifices of people from archaeological excavations, and many of the other things which he wrote about we have found evidence for in the archaeological record. What I don't know is how common that is, and it may be that only a few tribes in Gaul, which is the area he's talking about, actually did that, but I think we can assume that it probably is right for some places, and horrible though it may be, that's the way it was in Iron Age Gaul with Celtic peoples.
Now clearly with a burning sacrifice, normally we would have no archaeological evidence for that, but interestingly there is beginning to be a little bit of archaeological evidence that might point to this kind of ritual activity. For instance, quite recently a large pit was discovered at an Austrian settlement called Leonding, which seems to have consisted of a fire pit in which people were suspended in a kind of basket over a pit, and the whole thing was set fire to, and they found these charred remains of bodies at the bottom of the pit. We're dealing with something which happened in about, probably about 150 BC, and we're dealing with, and I think this is significant, victims in Austria who all suffered from the same congenital deformity of the jaw which made it impossible for them to speak. So we're dealing with selection of victims, and that kind of selection of victims with disabilities is something which we can trace in the bog bodies, in many other so-called sacrificial victims. But that fire sacrifice seems to be the closest we're going to get to our wicker man.
We may never know for sure if Caesar's description of the wicker man referred to a genuinely widespread practice, but there can be no doubt that his literary work provides us with a great deal of factual information. Like many other Roman writers, Caesar was also interested in a less sinister feature of the Celtic way of life, one which was also popular in Rome, feasting. Many classical sources tell of the Celtic enthusiasm for communal feasts. They describe the consumption of enormous quantities of food and especially drink. The famous crater found in the tomb at Veii would have been filled with wine for such an event. Its capacity is 1,100 litres. Time and again, classical writers marvelled at the Celtic tolerance for drink during their great banquets. But we know that the feast also served a vital social function. It brought the community together. Bards recited poems inspired by great tribal figures of the past. It was a time when the political affairs of the tribe could be discussed, and it was a time for warriors to prove themselves. The Greek writer Posidonius described how the finest cut of meat would be taken by the warrior who considered himself the greatest. If one of his fellows wanted the meat for himself, a fight to the death would be the result. Bloodshed was a regular feature of the famous Celtic feast.
The archaeological evidence and the literary evidence suggests that feasting was one of the central things that happened in Celtic life. And it had a social dimension and a religious dimension. We're dealing with a hierarchical society where really only the noble people had any say in what went on. But what the evidence suggests is that feasting was used at a time of festivals, at a time where people wanted to come together to talk about political events or social events. It was a means of bonding the community together, but also a means of sharing food between humans and the gods. So you'd eat something and the gods would eat something. And we have wonderful vessels like huge cauldrons that were clearly made for feeding 40 people at a time. Enormous tankards holding beer or berry juice or wine, probably meant to be passed around from mouth to mouth during these festivals. So very much an integral part of life, a means of discussing things, of perhaps talking about battle tactics or treaties, this kind of thing. So a mixture of the very, very serious and the entertainment as well.
The feast can be seen as one of the most appealing features of Celtic life. Roman writers were especially enthusiastic in their descriptions of it. But the Romans did not allow sentiment to get in the way of politics, and it was the Romans who would bring an end to the Celtic culture of mainland Europe. In 58 BC, Julius Caesar's legions advanced into the Celtic lands of Gaul. 5 years later, he had seized the greater proportion of Gallic territory. But the Celts were not finished yet, and a stupendous rebellion began to gather pace. By the spring of 52 BC, the diverse Gallic communities had succeeded in uniting themselves under the leadership of Vercingetorix, a young man from the Avernian tribe. In the weeks that followed, Vercingetorix led an enormous army against Caesar and the Romans. The Celts were now fighting together for their survival. Ultimately, their efforts were unsuccessful. But Vercingetorix did succeed in defeating Caesar at the Battle of Gergovia. Had he adopted a different tactic for the subsequent Battle of Alesia, the Romans may well have been driven out of Gaul altogether. It was one of the biggest confrontations of ancient times. On the plateau stronghold of Alesia, Vercingetorix made camp with 80,000 of his best troops, while his cavalry rode out into Gaul to raise a still greater force of warriors. Inspired by the victory of Gergovia, the Celtic leader confidently prepared to give battle with the most famous Roman of them all. But Caesar now proved his mastery of containing warfare. All round Vercingetorix's position, he ordered the construction of an enormous siege works. These pits, towers, and ramparts prevented the rebels from breaking out. The Romans then built a second outer siege works to protect themselves from attack from the outside. It was 10 miles in length, and it worked. When the main Celtic army arrived, it may have been a quarter of a million strong, but it failed to break through. After 3 brave attempts to relieve their leader, the attacking force broke up and Vercingetorix surrendered. Afterwards, he was taken to Rome and forced to take part in a triumphal procession. He was then ritually strangled. His rebellion had failed.
Vercingetorix might never have been able to defeat the Roman army.